righteousness which we have done where we have been saved, but it's through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and His grace. Let us see people there that are working in their own righteousness to try and attain salvation. There is nothing we can do. Christ has done it all. And that's what we're going to sing about this morning. Come and join and stand with us this morning as we enter into the holy place where we have access to the presence
of God. Who breaks the power? Darkness, whose love is mine, it's so much stronger. King of glory, King above all kings. Who takes the whole of who leaves his breath?
You are laid down.
You are so good. Thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night. But to tell me that you're pleasing, that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. To you are, to you are, to you are, and I'm loved by you. To I am, to I am, to I am. Far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. You provide it's what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father.
scripture to you this morning, part of my text. 1 John 5 and verse 4. It says, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. That's weak, church. Need your Starbucks this morning? Or you need faith? Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? And whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Lord, we praise you this morning. Pastor Ken, come and lead us in prayer. You might do a little better job than me.
I don't know if you want to do this, and if you're just doing it because I asked you, don't. But why don't you lift both your hands and say after me, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Now go ahead and bless the Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Lord, we don't praise you this morning because we have to. We praise you because you're worthy. We praise you because you are above all the tides of our affairs and the circumstances that surround us. We praise you that even in the passing political scene, which scares some of us, that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of the Lord and of his Christ. And he shall reign forever and ever. So we rejoice, and so we give you praise, and so we worship you in the splendor of your holiness. You are Lord alone. Hallelujah to your name. Amen.
Why don't you take a few minutes and greet one another, welcome someone new in the church and greet them. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's pass these around. Well, it's good to see everyone this morning. We missed you. Welcome back. It's good to see you. We have a crew of people here this morning. We're going to call the ushers up in a moment. There's a slide. Natalie's supposed to be here, but the debit machine is down, so we're just going to fly through this, right? Good. Pastor Kirby's going to help read this with you. There we go. Offering is an act of?
Worship.
Okay, you want to read it?
So offering is an act of worship. And then the next slide. I'm going to read that together. As we receive today's tithes and offering, we are believing you, Father, for heaven open, earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, and miracles created, dreams and vision, angelic visitations, declarations, impartations, and divine manifestations, anointing, giftings and calling, positions and promotions, provisions and resources to go to the nations, souls and more souls from every generation saved and set free, carrying kingdom revelations. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will shower favor, blessings, and increase upon me so I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven and see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah. Amen. Is there more? No, amen. Praise God. And the debit machine is back on. Look at this. Beautiful. And we just need to pray and declare, and things are coming to order. Amen? The ushers can come in. Amen. Do you believe in a declaration? Oh, I believe for an unlock. Oh, I do believe that for sure. Provision. Amen. Praise God. Let's pray. Brother Richie, want to pray?
Gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning for safe arrival of all those that went to your land, Lord. And Lord, that you're here with us this morning, as you are every day that we enter into your house. We just thank you, Lord, that we're able to give and give with a willing heart, Lord. We just give you praise for it. We ask, Lord, you to multiply it and give you the praise, honor, and glory. Amen.
God bless you as you give.
Shalom, shalom. Yeah, we're glad to be home too. It was good to go, but it's good to come home. We had beautiful experiences. You're going to hear about them, some of it, but the Lord is good. Amen. There's always moments that God really brought you through into a very deep connection with himself and with the Jewish people and even the Arabic people. And we came back with the burden of the Lord to pray. Amen. To see more souls saved. And I'm just going to give some announcement. It's 50 plus is March the 14th on Thursday, 11:30. Pastor DeStallo will also be here on March 17th. The Urdu service, March 16th at 6 p.m. Movie night on the 24th. Men's breakfast on the 30th. So just read your newsletter every week and see what's happening, even for Bible studies. On Wednesday night, we have a Bible study here. Get connected. Friday night youth and young adults, they have a... So we just want all of you to be connected. Amen? Thank you, Lord Jesus. We welcome also all of our new visitors. If you're new, we'd like to know where you are by raising your hands. We just want to know you're in the house. Amen. Praise God. Is there any new people today? Amen. Welcome. Yes. Hallelujah. Woohoo. Praise God.
Go ahead. Oh, okay.
Pastor Ray asked me to read a word this morning, so this is the word of the Lord this morning from the text. 2 Kings chapter 8 to 11. And it fell on a day that Elisha passed. Sorry? 2 Kings chapter 4. Eight. Yeah, chapter 4, verse 8 to 11. Oh. And it fell on a day that Elisha passed to Shunem, where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. And she said unto her husband, Behold now, I perceive that this is an holy man of God, which passeth by us continually. Let us make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set for him there a bed, and a table, and a stool, and a candlestick, and it shall be, when he cometh to us, that he shall turn in thither. And it fell on a day that he came thither, and he turned into the chamber, and lay there.
Amen. Clerk, did you want to give a quick report today? Okay.
So difficult to give a quick report. I'll start with saying Boker Tov. That's good morning in Hebrew. What an experience. What an experience. It exceeded our expectations, me and my wife's. There was some real high points. Like the baptism in the Jordan. Just being there, there's people from around the world, the singing. There was an Armenian group. Man, I think it'll sound like that in heaven. It was beautiful. And there were people from around the world, believers, Philippines, China. There were people from Indonesia, Muslim country. There were people from Holland. There were people from everywhere coming to just see where the Lord has walked. So we were so privileged to see it and to experience it. There's modern things, there's fertile things, there's growth, there's beauty, and then there's ancient things. I mean, when they talk about things that are not so old, they talk about things that are 2,000 years. It's not so old, because that's more recent. Then it goes back to 3,000 and 4,000. So it's just so much. And you stop at the different places, Capernaum, Caesarea. You stop at Bethlehem, you stop at Cana where the wedding was. And you can picture a little bit of that, how Jesus had to walk. He didn't take the VR train or the taxi. And some of those distances were long. So you get an understanding when you're on the Sea of Galilee and you get a feel for what it must have felt like. So what a privilege. And I wish somebody told me years ago that I should start planning to do it, to go. You know, you hear people go and they come back with a good report. But I wish somebody told me, start planning, start thinking about it. So now when we read the Bible, me and my wife in the morning, we see it talks about a valley in the Bible. And now we see the valley differently. It's not just a valley. We see a picture of a valley in Israel. So thank God for the privilege. And thank you, Brother Ryan, Sister Natalie, for putting it up and working hard to make it happen. It's not often that you go on a trip and you come back and you get served fruit at the airport. Yeah. That takes some planning. Thank you, Brother Ray.
Well, there's going to be more to share over the course of the weeks, of course. We have a short video presentation for you. Just, you know, we just came back, and so it was hard to pull everybody's videos together in pieces. So this is what we have for now. We'll have more later. Okay.
Them on the Sea of Galilee about faith. He told them to get into the boat, and he said, we're going to the other side. But But sometimes we forget what he said. And we get into the boat, and the weather's good. Yeah. But they got into the middle of the sea, and the weather turned on them. Mm-hmm. And the weather can turn on you on a dime in this area. And as you see today, sunny, raining, sunny, windy. So, and they turned on them. But Jesus gave them a promise, didn't he?
Yeah. Yeah.
But they forgot the promise, and they started to worry. They forgot the promise. And so he had to remind them, oh, you little faith. And so oftentimes, many lessons were learned about life and about trusting and about faith right here on the sea.
Well, that was a 5-minute fast clip. Yeah. So many lessons to be shared, so many truths to be unveiled. God willing, we will do that in the course of time. And just the historical elements are powerful. Amen? I see some of the team is here and some of them are not here this morning. But we're going to pick up on it tonight, and some more will be sharing probably a little bit more details this evening on that. The text I read to you earlier from 1 John chapter 5, we're going to move that sermon till tonight. Our faith that overcomes the world. Is that okay? This morning, as Daniel has read for us, let's take a look at this scripture before we go into communion service. As we look at God's Word, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 9 again. And it says, "And she said to her husband, 'Look now, I know that this is a holy man of God who passes by us regularly. Father, open our ears, uncircumcise our hearts, and uncircumcise our ears, that we might see those things that you want us to see by your word, in Jesus' name, amen.'" Amen? I meant circumcise. All right. The Bible says here, "And she said to her husband, 'Look now, and this is the holy man of God who passes by us regularly.'" Look now. This word here is very important because she discerned something. And she discerned it because it happened regularly or constantly. There was something happening, but there was more to take place. Are you with me this morning? This is Elijah. The power of God was in this vessel, was passing by regularly, but they were not catching it.
And so what was she saying? Let us make a small upper room on the wall, and let us put up a bed for him there, and a table and a chair and a lampstand, so it'll be that whenever he comes to us, he can turn in there. She discerned something. She wanted to make a room. Say, make a room. Make a room for a miracle. Make a room. And you know how many times that some things happen that Jesus is passing by and he's saying, make room for us. You see, Elisha was represented here. When we look at Luke chapter 18, verse 37, it talks about Jesus was passing by. Jesus was passing by. And you know, our response to when Jesus passes by is really important. In Luke chapter 19, verse 1, it says again that he entered Jericho. Say Jericho. He entered Jericho and he was passing through. He was about to pass through. In Mark chapter 6, verse 48, it says he would have passed them by. This is mind-boggling. He would have passed them by. I know you don't know the full story of what I'm referring to, but you will in a moment. So the emphasis on passing by, passing through. And she says, the Shunammite woman says, as he was passing by, she said, look now, I know this holy man who passes by us regularly. How many of us are simply content with just filing into church and filing out like a herd? And we miss the moment. We miss the divine moment that he wants to do something in our midst. You see, I'll tell you something. This can be an ordinary, regular Sunday if you don't add faith to it. You see, faith is the substance of things hoped for. Why did you come this morning? Were you invited? Are you here to just check in on your insurance policy? Are you just here because it's Sunday? Are you here because you come with a spirit of anticipation? Maybe a spirit of expectation. You see, this woman discerned that this was a man of God. She discerned that this guy was just passing by and he was doing regularly. Regularly. You see, there was a barrenness in her. She had no son. But that's not why that she was looking for this. She wanted to have something more. You see, Jesus wanted us to learn something from this woman. She discerned that the holy man of God was passing by regularly. And he will continue to pass by if we don't make room for him. You see, it's when we make room for him that his presence will produce his power. What is your faith reaching out for this morning? The Bible tells us right from the beginning of Genesis is that the Spirit of God was moving upon the surface. You see, the Spirit of God will only move on the surface until we give him room, and then he will go into the deep things of our life. Amen? The provision is in the moving. You see, the river keeps moving. The river keeps flowing, and there are certain things that the river keeps pushing ahead until we get into the river. Until we are immersed and baptized into the river, we will never get and catch the treasure that the river is pushing forward. You follow me? God is not obligated by need. There are myriads of need all across this globe. There are myriads of hungry people. There are myriads of sick people. There are myriads of famished people. There are myriads of poverty-stricken people. But God is only motivated and moved when he sees people who are moving towards him, who are making room for him. You see, the woman discerned that this was Elisha. If perhaps Elisha represented anything, maybe he represents the power of God. Because he had the double anointing that Elijah had. And Jesus said in John 14, verse 12, you shall do greater things than I do when I go to my Father. And if Elisha represents the power of God, the power of God fell in the upper room. And what did this woman create? She created room in the upper places, in the chief concourses, in the best of things, in the best of time, with the best of her talent, with the best of her ability. She says, I'm going to make room. I'm going to make this upper room on the wall. And let it be a bed there for him. Let it be a table there for him. Let it be a chair there for him. And let it be a lampstand there for him. And that whenever he comes to us, he can turn in hither. Is there room for God in your life? More so, is there room for God the Holy Spirit in your life? Is there an upper room in your life? Well, we were in the upper room. We didn't show you the pic yet. But there was prayer going on every corner. There were the Africans praying in the Afrikaans. Praying. There were the other languages praying, as Clerk referred about. And then we started our own prayer meeting in one side and one corner of the upper room. We've got to make room for him, beloved. Amen. We've got to stand and make room for him. Look at in Luke chapter 18, we see in this very gospel that in Luke, we see that Jesus is coming through and blind Bartimaeus hears about it. He can't see about it, but he hears about it. Whatever faculty you have that's functioning, use it. Don't complain about what's not functioning. Use what gift and what talent God has given you already and stop comparing. He didn't have sight, but he had ears to hear what the Spirit was saying. So it happened, it says, and you know what? There's a happening right now. And it says, as he was coming near Jericho, that a certain blind man sat by the road begging. And I tell you, there's a lot of beggars around, though we didn't see any in Israel. And he said, hearing a multitude passing by, he asked what it meant. Sometimes you need an understanding. So he asked what it meant. So they told him, Jesus of Nazareth was passing by. And what happened? He cried out. He cried out. What did he do? He cried out, saying, what? Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Amen. And then those who were, you went before him, warned him that he should be quiet. Isn't there religious folks around? Shh. Shh. As if God could be disturbed. Shh. Only you could be disturbed. God cannot be disturbed. God needs to be disturbed. God needs for somebody to get out of their chair and somebody to get desperate for him and say, look, Lord, I need you. I need to get your attention. What will make him stand still for the blind? Oh, we know in Joshua chapter 10 that Joshua made him stand, made the sun, S-U-N, stand still over Gibeon and the moon to stand still over the valley of Ejalon. He made the son of creation to stand when the enemy came against Joshua. But what is even greater is that blind Bartimaeus, not a captain of the host of the army, just a simple beggar, a simple lowlife, a simple low caste man who was a social misfit and an outcast, was able to make Jesus stand still. What do you think moved Jesus? Faith. What do you think tried to silence him? The religious crowd who've been in church too long. You know what I mean. They're religious but not righteous. They lost their fervency. They lost their zeal for the house of God. They lost their zeal for souls. They lost their zeal for the presence of God. They're just filing in, filing out, doing their religious duty. Some church folks try to hush his enthusiasm. But you know what happened? They told him, shh, be quiet. What does the Bible tell us in verse 39? He cried out all the more. He He cried out all the more. He cried out all the more. You see, you can miss your miracle by just sitting there. You see, don't minimize my praise or think we are emotionally shallow because we feel a hallelujah stirring up inside of our bones when we went through a week that was loaded with hell coming against us. There'll be always somebody trying to quench your fire, but let it not be a brother or a sister. Amen. Amen. So don't minimize my praise. You may be one shout away from a miracle. Amen. Because the Bible says when they told him to shh, he cried out all the more. And what did he say? He said, Son of David, Son of David, have mercy on me. Amen. That got Jesus' attention pretty fast. How are you going to get the attention of Jesus today? When there's a crowd around, you know, there's always spectators. There's always the criticism. There's always the critical thinker. There's always, you know, this group and that group and the other group. They're all in the crowd, even this morning. But you've got to press through the crowd. Press through the voices. Press through the pride. Press through whatever people think of you, even what you think of yourself. Think about getting his attention. Come on, think about what? Getting his attention. Jesus heard the cry for mercy. He said, Son of David, have mercy on me. Does anybody need mercy today? Hallelujah. I need the mercy of God bubbling up in my soul. And the Bible says in verse 40, Jesus stood still. Jesus stood still. Jesus stood still. And he commanded him to be brought to him. Wow. This guy was no Roman centurion. This guy was no high priest. This guy wasn't commanding the legions of the Roman army. This guy wasn't the head of anything. He was blind Bartimaeus begging by the roadside. And Jesus stood still. And he commanded him to be brought to him. Whoa, he got his miracle for crying out loud. You can get your miracle for crying out loud. Hey? Oh, you say it's just energy. No, it's not just energy. It's the Holy Ghost in me. It's the fire of God in me burning, burning, burning more now than ever before. Is your faith rock solid? Come on. You know, on the way back from Israel, we stood, Natalie and I sat with a seat of three, and at the end was a young man, 15 years old. 15 years old. And he was always smiling, you know. He'd watch his TV a bit. He'd look over at me, and he'd smile. We wanted to strike up a conversation, so we struck up a conversation. You know, we talked aloud. You know, it was over about 11-hour flight on the way back, and we talked a lot. Found out he went to Israel too with his siblings. He was the oldest of four. And I said, so what did this trip do for you? He said, it anchored my faith. It made my faith solid. It encouraged me, built me up. He goes, you know, I work on a farm. My daddy owns a 6,000-acre farm in Regina. And he said, we always get challenged and checked and everything else. He said, you know, we got a lot of pressure on farming, timing, seasons, all of this. He said, but every Sunday, my father says, no work. No workers on the field. We're in church. He said, I didn't get it all the time. But he said, I got it now. I got it. I said, wow, you got what your daddy was trying to teach you. He goes, I got it. He said, well, you got to honor the Lord first, not our jobs, not our money. God is not our money. Our time is not our money. People are not our gods, but God is God. Amen? Listen, if a 15-year-old can get it, why can't some of us get it? This is the day of the Lord. This is the house of the Lord, and this is where we honor the Lord. on the day of the Lord as the people of God. He got his miracle for crying out loud. All you got to do is cry out loud. You're just one hallelujah away. Amen. Amen. So we heard about passing by. We heard about, you know, and he was going to pass through. You see, the next miracle we see, you see, Jesus was about to pass through. And we see that, you know, okay, I'm going to save that one for later. But let's look at Mark 6. Mark 6, are you with me? Are you with me? Mark 6, verse 48. Look at this one. Jesus says here, he tells his disciples to get into the boat and go to the other side. And you heard of this on the video, and it was from a different portion. And so we see that he tells them, and he goes into the mountain to pray. It's evening, and the boat was in the middle of the sea, and he was alone on the land, and he saw them straining at rowing. They were straining in their natural strength, but the wind was against them. Is there anything against you? And about the fourth watch, you know what the fourth watch is, don't you? It's about 3 o'clock in the morning. About 3 o'clock in the morning, you see, here they are, and they are at night, and he came to them walking on the sea, and he would have passed them by. He would have passed them by. Doesn't that boggle your mind? While he wanted to go into their boat, and while he wanted to be in with them, he was waiting for an invitation. He was waiting for someone to cry out. He was waiting for someone to say, Lord, I have desperate need of you. He would have passed them by, the Bible says. But when they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed it was a ghost crying out. And when they all saw him, they were troubled. Immediately he talked with them and he said to them, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. Think of it. They were rowing. They were toiling in their natural strength. They were fighting against the wind and the waves of their human trials of their life. They were fighting as best they could. And he was walking on their troubles. He was walking on their worries. They were rowing. They were struggling. But he was walking. What you're struggling with, what you're worrying about, God is walking on right now. He was walking on top what they were worrying about. You hear me? Does your spirit receive what I just said? He's walking on your troubles. He's walking on your little minuscule problems that you have magnified to be larger than him. You see, we went to an area called the God of Pan. And we'll talk about it some more. But in this God of Pan is a word where we get panic attacks from. Do you know panic attacks, anxious thoughts, are from the pit of hell, from another God that invented those panic attacks? Not from God. The Bible says, when he got into the boat, verse 51, the wind ceased. Say it, the wind ceased. It means it no longer existed. It was no longer in existence. What would happen to your disease if it no longer existed? What would happen if Jesus spoke a word right now? What would happen if he was passing by and you got his attention with a praise out of your belly, with a shout out of your spirit, and he said, wind, cease? What would it look like in your house from now on? If that disease just disappeared, or if that depression just ceased and no longer existed, what would happen right now if your addiction just broke right now? What would happen if that addiction just broke? That thing that you were trying to get rid of in your own strength, rowing, striving. You tried everything, but you didn't come to Jesus. What would happen to your marriage right now if you stop making excuses, stop pointing the finger? What would happen to your marriage right now if you stop striving in the flesh and say, Lord, I'm going to stop fighting this. I'm going to stop trying in the natural. I'm going to close the exit door, and I'm going to surrender to you. I'm going to surrender to you. What would happen? The Bible says the wind ceased. The problem no longer existed. Amen? What would happen? Right now, that's what would happen. Why? Because I am not that person anymore. Amen? I am not that person anymore. Why am I not that person? Because Jesus dealt with my sin. I've been born again. Where did it go? It went into the sea. Maybe it went into the Dead Sea, and it died there, and it was buried there. Come on. Is that a possibility? Those of you who've been in the Dead Sea know nothing lives in there, in the macro. Anyways, amen. There's some things that need to cease. Let's make a beeline to the cross. Amen. So are we desperate to see him? Well, let's go back to Luke. Is that okay? One more story. You know, I could have preached 7 messages out of this one. But here we go. Maybe 3 or 4. But let's go to the last illustration. Luke chapter 19. Don't you just love this? Here is this story. He was going through Jericho. He entered and he passed through Jericho. But it happened that there was a man named Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus means pure, innocent. He was nothing but. He was dirty. He had been messed up in sin. He was the chief tax collector. Everybody hated the tax collector. Do you like the tax man? I know it's tax season right now, and you're waiting to get back your refund. I hope we see 10. Okay. But, you know, they all hated the tax collectors, and especially the chief of them. True? Still nothing changed today. And he was rich. Of course he was rich. He took a handsome cut. Now, the Bible tells us he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd. The crowd blocked his view, for he was of short stature. Zacchaeus had wealth. Zacchaeus had position, but he was too short to enjoy it all. And so when he couldn't see through the crowd, what did he do? He said he was short of stature. Do you know what? You are short of something too. You may have education. You may live on the best side of town, but you're short of something, because the Bible tells me in Romans chapter 3, for all have fallen short. Not only Zacchaeus fell short, but all of us have fallen short of the glory of God. How are you going to get out of that one? Okay, this is how you get out of it. Let me tell you. Let's go on. So what happens? So he ran ahead. Come on, say ran ahead. And he climbed up a sycamore tree to see him. Do you want to see him? Are you desperate? You see, here's another blind Bartimaeus. Here's a man who wants not Jesus to pass by. He wants to see Jesus. He wants to see him eyeball to eyeball. He wants to make facial contact. Is there anybody in that optic range that you want to see this morning? All right, so here we see. He jumps up the sycamore tree, and he was going to pass by that way. And when Jesus came to that place, he looked up and he saw him. And he said to him, Zacchaeus, wow. Make haste, come down, for today I must stay at your house. Woo! Here's another guy who got Jesus to stand still for a moment. Why? Because he wasn't tired of the status quo. He didn't want to be at the back of the line. He didn't want to be at the back of the crowd. He said, I'm going to run ahead, and I'm going to jump on that sycamore tree, and I'm going to climb that sycamore tree, and I'm going to see him. You know what that tree is? That tree is the tree that Jesus died on, the sycamore tree. It says in Deuteronomy, the curse is the one who dies on a tree. Jesus died on a cross that was made out of a tree. That's why Deuteronomy uses the word tree. Your answer lies in a tree. Your answer lies in the blood of Jesus. Your answer lies in what Bartimaeus said, have mercy on me. Your answer doesn't lie in your good works. Your answer doesn't lie in your pedigree. The answer doesn't lie in your degrees or your wealth. Your answer lies in a tree, Zacchaeus. The tree enlarged Zacchaeus. The tree made Zacchaeus see Jesus. And more importantly, the tree made Jesus see Zacchaeus. His faith was not relying in himself or in his wealth, but the tree realized that his faith was relying in a tree. My faith is in the cross. Jesus who died on that tree. Amen? That's the answer, folks. As we come, you see, you got to get to that tree called Calvary. Jesus sees you, and he says, come down. Not only does Zacchaeus get saved that day, but what does the Bible tell us? The Bible tells us, he says, make haste. Just like how Zacchaeus ran ahead, Jesus now says, make haste, Zacchaeus, run one more time. Not only have you got saved, now your house is going to get saved. Make haste to see that all your children are saved. Make haste to see that all your family is saved. Make haste and come down today, for I must, what? Stay at your house. Praise team, come back. That's the key, folks. Jesus wants to stay at our house. Jesus wants to stay in Brantford. Jesus wants a holy habitation. He inhabits the praises of his people. Jesus doesn't want to just pass us by regularly. Jesus doesn't just want to visit you on a Sunday. He wants to be Lord, not on a Sunday. You know why the problem is? That why people don't know Jesus as Lord and only Savior? I don't understand that theology, but some have somehow deciphered and dissected it to be so. But you see, they're not experiencing the fullness of God. It's because Jesus is only Lord on Sunday and for 2 hours max. They're back in the mall, they're back in the park, they're back on the football field, they're back in the golf course, they're back at work after 2 hours of allegiance. That 15-year-old boy told me what his father did. They shut down a 6,000-acre farm every Sunday. And I think they're doing pretty good to take their whole family to Israel. Went through Europe. I think God somehow blessed them richly because they obeyed his word. You follow me? When you try to do it in your natural thinking, you're going to be straining at the oars, fighting those winds, fighting those troubles. But when you relinquish and you let God walk supernaturally on your problems, on your worries, he will do it. When you walk by faith, this is the victory that overcomes the world. What is that victory that overcomes the world? Even our faith. Even your faith. Amen? Jesus said, I'm coming to your house. Has Jesus told you that? I'm coming to your house. You see, he was going to change the future of his whole family. He was going to break every curse. He was going to heal every wound. He was going to undo what the curse has done from Adam. And he was going to set them on a new track, on a new course, and a new whole family. Your answer is in that tree. Stand with me. Stand with me. Build him a room right now. Why did you come here this morning? Build him room. The Shunammite woman got it. Jesus, don't pass by here anymore. Don't let this prophet, this man of God, pass by here anymore. Let's build him an upper room. Make room. Matthew 9, you know, they were mocking when that person was dead. They were laughing. Jesus says, be quiet. Get them out of this place. Is God talking to you? Maybe he's not talking to all of you, but I believe he is, because some of you may not be listening. Make room. Make room. Make the upper room available, the best of rooms, the best places of your time. Right now, let's start it with right now, the beginning of March, beginning of spring. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift your hands. Lift your voices. Lift your hearts. Oh God. We make room for the Holy Spirit to have His way. We make room for the wind of the Spirit of God to blow in this place. We make room right now. We lay down pride. We lay down those things that battle our flesh right now. Church, is anybody desperate for a miracle? Is anybody hungry for a move of God? Is anybody wanting what blind Bartimaeus wanted? Think of it. Zacchaeus didn't have any sicknesses. Zacchaeus didn't have any financial woes. But in his heart, he knew that wealth wasn't the answer. In his heart, he knew that he was empty with all that wealth, all that worldly possession. He knew he was empty. He had a need to see Jesus. And that may be your greatest need tonight. You may not need a healing. Your marriage may be perfect. Everything may be lined up, but in your heart, you know there is a vacuum. You know there's a God-shaped vacuum that only God can fill, that only the Spirit of God can inhabit. And that may be your hunger today. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God, sing us a song. Let's worship Him. Let's worship Him. Let's worship Him.
Beautiful day.
Hallelujah. Put your hands together and praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him. Give Him a shout of praise. Praise Him. Hallelujah. For crying out loud, praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him. Give Him praise out of your belly, your innermost being. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Death could not hold you. Jesus. Oh, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I believe God is going to do some mighty things this morning. I believe in the power of God. I believe in the Word of God. It is not important for me to preach the Word only. What is more important than me preaching the Word is your response. That is what is called the altar call. Your response, whether you make it to the altar or not, has everything to do with what you take away this morning. Do you hear me, church, on the left and the right, in the center and the back? Your response is everything to the Word that quickens us. Faith is the victory. You may not have been to Israel. You may say, Pastor, you don't know what it is living on my side of the tracks. You're dressed nice. You've got a tan. You know, you just went to Israel. I got to live by faith. And that's what he said. You don't have to go to the Holy Land to meet Jesus. His Spirit is in us. His Spirit is amongst us. You just got to make room for him this morning. You got to push back your lunch plans. You got to push back whatever else and say, I'm desperate for you this morning. Do you hear my cry? You see, you don't know what trials are like. Oh, yeah, I lost my wallet on the trip. I've never in a half a century lost my wallet. And I lost it there. I don't know what devil took it, but it's gone. Who cares? I'll get another one. Yesterday, I was on my way, you know, in the morning to get all my driver's license, my OHIP, everything. So I was gone early in the morning, line, you know, I got in there, got everything filled out. And I was saying, okay, I'm going to make it to church in good time. And I'm pulling out of the back driveway onto Harris. And this tow truck doesn't see me. 1 week on the job, comes with his full gas through the press down. And he comes right at me. I said, oh, Lord, he's going to hit me. And I'm trying to swerve out of the way as best as possible. We miss a head-on collision. I get sideswiped on the front. And there goes my early desire to be at church. But through it all, those things are nothing. Those things are nothing. You can't let anything rob your joy. Amen? I still got a smile on my face. I'm still 10 pounds overweight by eating too much in Israel. I still have a beautiful wife and a beautiful church and a beautiful family. I'm still alive to praise God. Come on, let's praise Him. Come on, let's give Him a shout of praise. Let's sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. You may be seated for a moment, if you can. Is Rashida here this morning? Okay, that's fine. She wanted to just testify. Praise God. While we're serving communion, I'm just going to invite... before we invite the other team, Jay, would you come? Jay and Maria, whoever's going with you to Tanzania. Tanzania. While communion is being passed, we'll take this moment to just tell us where you're going and how we can pray for you.
Amen. Well, thank you. Awesome service. Yeah, to make room in our hearts for Jesus. You know, as I was sitting there listening to worship, I mean, there's so many things involved in doing a trip to Africa. And there's six of us going, two adults and four young adults, children. There's a lot involved, and sometimes you can allow, you know, aspects of fear to kind of come in. And first time traveling overseas for some of us. Yeah, I want to make room for faith. So we do ask for your prayers. We're leaving this Wednesday to Tanzania, East Africa. We're going back to look after the work that my mom and different people have started over there. So we're going to be there for 2 weeks, speaking at a couple of different churches. We're doing a youth event. We're doing a compassion. We're helping out at a compassion event where we're going to be feeding the children there. We're going to be visiting the two boys' homes, the schools that they go to. We're going to have some free time to do some sightseeing and different things like that. But we do ask for your prayers for safe journeys as we're flying. We're excited about the flights, but also some of us, this is going to be first time on flights. So it's about 20 hours of flying plus airport time. That's not even including the inland flight. So there's a lot of travel things that we're doing. Also, when we're there, we do ask that you pray for us that we'd stay healthy, because food is definitely a challenge when we're there, the different types of foods and our stomachs and things like that. So we do ask for your prayers in that, and ask for favor and grace, because we are believing that, last time I went to Africa, I felt the Lord give me that scripture verse says that, ask of me and I'll give the nations as your inheritance, the ends of the earth for your inheritance. So it is our inheritance, but we do ask. We were going to be speaking at different churches and stuff, and so sharing the words, we ask that people would pray for us, that God would turn the hearts for people in Africa, that people would again get saved. Awesome. So we do thank you for your prayers.
Amen. You stay close to the front wherever you can. We're going to have a time of prayer in our prayer time to pray for them as they go. Amen. I know they're still handing it out, but or shall we just pray now? All right. Wonderful. Is Margaret Gibbs still here? Oh, there you are. You're hidden behind. Come on up, Margaret. Margaret just came back from Bogota, and I met her coming in. And she says, "You got to go to Bogota, Colombia." Is that right?
Yeah, we're invited. I praised you in Colombia. I sang your praises.
You're sweet. God bless you. Would you pray for them as they go to... let's pray with our dear Margaret as she prays over them. Thank you. everyone get communion served? If you are missed, please let us know. Welcome back, Donna. It's good to have Donna Martin feedback. And for those of you who know, we're going to believe God for miracles for her, too. Amen. Thank you, Father. You know, there's so many testimonies. I wish I could call Debbie up here. We had communion at the Garden Tomb. And it was there. I didn't get all the reports yet, but I know Debbie Toombs got a breakthrough there. Debbie, are you there? Are you here? I don't see you. Can you do a quick one? I just want to stir up faith, if they haven't stirred up already from my preaching. Just quickly. Look at her walking. She had...
Well, we went into the Garden Tomb, and Pastor Ray and Natalie and Wayne, and I don't know who else was in there with us. And I felt when Pastor Ray started praising in there, I felt a real invigoration in my body. And we went out and we took communion, and our prayers raised up to heaven. I haven't been able to do this, walk up and down the stairs consecutively. I was not able to go some of the places because I couldn't walk, and I charged up the hill to the bus. But even further and more precious than that was the time on the bus that Wayne and I had alone, and we shared with each other, and I shared from my heart. And God revealed to me that I had a deep-seated unforgiveness in myself, and I sought the Lord, and I said, God, against who? I couldn't think of anyone, and God spoke to me. He said, against yourself, I needed to forgive myself of things that happened in the past. So praise God, I'm free. Hallelujah.
Some good stuff. Thank you, Lord. Hold the bread. This represents His body, broken for you and for me. Isaiah gives a pretty clear, vivid description. That he turned into from a human to a person without form, unrecognizable, so beaten by men, so lacerated, flogged, but even more than that, on the cross, he became the sin bearer. He took it all for you. Would you lay down all your sins? Even the sins you think God cannot forgive. Even the sins that other people will hold against you. And those of you holding somebody else captive because they did you wrong, you need to let it go. You need to forgive them as God has forgiven you. Because that's what divides families, churches, communities. In the light of His sacrifice, we ought to be the most forgiving people on the face of this world. We ought to be the most loving, caring, compassionate people in the light of His great ultimate sacrifice. So, Father, forgive us as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Let's partake. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your body. make us whole. Make marriages whole. Make relationships whole. He took the cup. He said, "This is my blood." Wash away my sin? What can make me whole again? Oh, precious is that flow that makes me whiter than snow. Let's drink it to wash us. Deacons are here. We have pastors, servants of God in our midst. We're going to stand. I'm going to invite even the Israel team to come. We're just going to open up the altars. Is that okay? We make room. If you need to go, God bless you. But we're just going to take some time and we're going to pray. I forgot my prayer shawl in my office, but let's just pray anyways, because God is here. Gentlemen, would you grab the anointed oil? Donna, would you come? So good to have you back from Florida. Many of you know that Donna needs a miracle, and God is her miracle. She's come back, and we want to pray for Donna. How should we pray for you?
My faith is strong. It is. I believe that God's going to help me beat this cancer. The healthiest 71-year-old that I knew 2 weeks ago. I was moving a 200-pound table, and I was on a ladder painting my friend's dining room. And 2 days later, I was in the hospital told I have cancer throughout my bones, especially my wrists, and that my bones are going to start breaking. No, I didn't receive it. I said, "You must be in the wrong room." And then they did another test, and they said one of the cancer cells attacked the inside of my skull and that it's bleeding, and that's a real concern, and the doctor doesn't understand why I'm talking and why I don't have blurred vision and why I don't have severe headaches. I said, "I haven't had a headache since 1980, the day I got saved, and I'm not having one now." So I believe with your prayers that God's going to get me through this. I really do.
We love Donna, don't we? We're standing with her. We're standing with Christina. We're standing with Asunta. We're standing with all of us who have need. If you need to be anointed this morning, the Bible says you call for the elders. We're giving you that opportunity. This is a time to exercise faith. Amen. And let's just believe them and press them through to the front of the line. You guys want to sing? You go ahead. We're going to anoint people with oil. We're going to pray. And Margaret, come and help us too. And let's just do that right now. Thank you, Lord. If you need a breakthrough, you need a touch, you just come now. This is at that time. Or if you want to sit in your seat and intercede and pray, lift up your hands to God and just be an intercessor.